Welcome to the Grok Shop and part 5 in my series, the Kodi Compendium. In this video, I'll be doing a basic Kodi config, including a full media library import into Kodi, as well as looking at some of the different skins and skin selection. If you've been following along, you'll know I'm running Kodi on osmc on Raspberry Pi. So we're going to start out with some OS configuration, and with the osmc, that's pretty easy. We'll just go to Programs, and then go to the My osmc add-on. Here I'm showing how to get to the settings app from a standard skin. If you don't have a standard skin and you have the default OSMC skin, it's even easier. You just go to My OSMC right off the main menu. So starting with the network config, you just go to the connectivity icon at the bottom there, and you can set it up for wired or wireless. I got mine set up for wireless right now, but you can see what wired looks like using DHCP or wireless using a manual setup. I like to manually configure my IPs, and I recommend you do as well. Just makes life a little easier. Next, let's configure the OS updates. Just go to the cloud at the top up there. By default, it's set up to do daily random updates. I don't like that. I like to be in control, so I set mine to never. You can do it however you want, but typically I like to go out and manually check for updates once every few months, so that way things tend to remain more stable. But you can go through here and alter the settings according to your preferences. If it's your first time in here, you may want to go ahead and scan for updates now. I'll go ahead and do that here. Okay, next, since I'm going to run multiple Kodi boxes and I want to have a centralized library, I'm going to set up a centralized database. If you don't set up a centralized database, Kodi will maintain a local database in SQLite. Everything will run fine, but the advantage of having a centralized database is you don't have to add media to each database. Also, you have resume points, so like if you stop a movie in one room, you can pick it up in another room. So if you do run a centralized database, you want to put it on a box that's on all the time, like a NAS, network attached storage, or similar. I run a Synology NAS, and I have both my media and my central database all on that same box. So here on my Synology, I'm just going to turn on MariaDB10, which is an offshoot of MySQL, and Kodi only supports MariaDB or MySQL. So I'm just setting the root password up. This will be the root password for accessing MariaDB. Okay, next we're going to fire up phpMyAdmin. We're going to log in with the same credentials we just created. And you want to make sure you've got that right database server selected below under server choice. Okay, next we'll head over to the user accounts tab. And down under new there where it says add user account, we'll click that. And the username we're going to use right now is just the default OSMC. And the password is the default OSMC. Now, of course, that's not the most secure login in the world. This is just for demonstration purposes. You can use something different if you're worried about getting your media library hacked. All right, next, just scroll on down to the Go button, hit Go, and then we have our new user, but he can't do much. So what we want to do is give sort of super user privileges to this guy. So we'll head over to the SQL tab and enter in this SQL. I'll put this in the description below. But this allows him to do everything he needs to do to create and manage the Kodi databases. And now we just want to get the port that we're going to use for our database. So we click on the SQL tab and enter this SQL here. And out pops the port. You can right click and copy. I'll put this SQL in the description below. Okay, so now back on our Kodi box at the bottom of connectivity, we select MySQL there on the left and then enable MySQL Video DB and enable MySQL Music DB. So now I'll just put in the IP address for my NAS box, as well as the port for MariaDB, which we just got, as well as the username and password for the user we created. And we'll go ahead and let Kodi put both databases on this MariaDB database server. That kind of makes things simple. I don't really have any need to separate them, but of course you could if you wanted. The last two options here are only applicable if you've exported your library from another Kodi before. So now when it comes to accessing our media files across the network, we want the fastest possible file protocol available. And since we're on a Linux platform and we're getting our files from a Linux platform, it's a no-brainer to use NFS. It'll just destroy the performance of Samba. Now, if you happen to have your files on a Windows box and you're running your Kodi on a Windows platform, then using Samba might be okay since it's native to those platforms. But in general, an all Linux, Linux client, Linux server, NFS file protocol is the fastest possible solution. The only thing is NFS is slightly more difficult to configure than Samba. Probably the easiest way to get NFS to work on your NAS box with your Kodi box is to have a special entry in your Etsy exports. So basically each entry is for one folder. Here I have volume1/media, and then it's an entry just for the IP of the Kodi box. So the .1.10 is my Kodi box. Notice I have insecure and all squash set. So in effect, it's kind of like you have a public folder, but it's only public for this IP address. So now, of course, you can edit that Etsy exports directly, or you can use a GUI like here for Synology. I just go to Control Panel, Shared Folder, and I'll right-click the folder I want to modify, hit Edit, and then we go to NFS Permissions, and up here there's a button for creating a new entry. I already have it, so I'll hit the Edit button, but you'll get something that looks the same, and you can configure it from here. So now, without further ado, we can start adding our media. I'm going to click Videos, Files, and then Add Videos. And the first thing we want to do is add this network location that we're sharing. That'll make it easier to add our sources. So I'll click Browse here. And then I'm just going to scroll down to the bottom where it says Add Network Location. And we'll click that. And then we'll select the protocol, which in our case here will be NFS. And then I'll browse to find any NFS shares that are available. They get broadcasted, so your Kodi should find the one that you've made available. Well, there we are. And also browse to the one path that was shared. And then inside this folder, of course, we can see our source folders that we have all set up, but we don't want to select any yet. We just want to select OK. Now coming out of that browse view, we'll just hit OK again. And now we can see our new network location all set up. All right, so now we're ready to add our first media source. Back out at the main menu, we'll hit Videos, Files, and Add Videos. And then we'll go to Browse. And then we'll go to our new network location that we just set up. And we can see the different sources that are in there. I'm going to go ahead and add the Concerts media source. And it shows all the content inside the folder, but we'll scroll down to OK. Okay, now here we could edit the label or name from the media source. I'm okay with the folder name, which is the default. We could also add more sources if we want and do multiple sources at a time. We'll just hit OK now. Okay, next we need to set the content type for our source. In this case, for music concerts, they are not considered music videos. They're considered movies. So we'll set it to movies. And then we can set information providers. I'm okay with the default, the movie database for now. And then there's additional options we can set. I'm just going to basically accept all the defaults. I don't have any particular need to change these, but you can change them later if you want. Since our library is all properly groomed, remember part 4, we'll go ahead and tell it movies are in separate folders that match the title, do scan recursively, and do not exclude path from library updates. So we just hit OK, and then yes, refresh information for all items, which means update the library. As we can see here in the top right, it's scanning our concerts into the library. Once that initial scan is complete, you might see it go out and fetch some additional artwork. So now back up at the main menu, we'll select movies, and if all goes well, we'll see our concerts, and here we are. And so we'll just select one, test it out, make sure everything's rolling. So now with this first import verified, it's just a matter of rinse and repeat for all of your other video, movie, and TV show media sources. All right, now we need to add our music sources. So we'll go to the main menu, select Music, and then Files, and Add Music. And then we'll browse to that network location that we added. From here, we'll scroll to our music folder. And don't forget, in here we have multiple sources as well. I'm going to go ahead and add the compilation source folder now. Now just select OK. And make sure you've got the right path and that you're okay with that name. I'm just going to leave it the same again. Select OK. Yes, we want to add the media from the source to the library. Here again, we can see it munging away. Of course, when this finishes, we'll want to add the rest of our music media sources. Once they're all added, you should be able to go to Music from the main menu and see your music in the library. hopefully with at least some album art. Looks good. Next, we want to set up our skin. So go to the main menu and select Settings, and then Interface, and then Skin. And now we can have some fun playing with some different skins. So let's start out by taking a quick look at Confluence. Confluence was the default skin for many years. It was recently replaced by Estuary, but Confluence still receives a lot of love in the community. It's still a good skin. I like it. It's very fast and snappy, but it's sort of basic and it's not very easily extensible. So when it comes to skins, a lot of this just goes down to personal taste and preference, but there are some objective considerations to make. For example, being able to customize the home menu, I like that a lot because I can make it less steps to get down to my media. So I'll put some of my media sources directly on the home menu. You just can't easily do that with Confluence. You can, but it's a major pain. You don't want to go there, believe me. Another consideration, especially for Raspberry Pi users, is speed. Some of these skins are pretty heavy and they get kind of slow on the Pi, even the Raspberry Pi 3B Plus, which I'm using. So these are things that I'm going to kind of review here. But with Confluence, speed's not really an issue. It's just you can't customize that home menu. One example of a lightweight skin that you can customize is Arctic Zephyr. I'll show that to y'all here now. And I like this skin because it looks very clean and it is lightweight and you can customize the home menu. And keep in mind, when you're looking at some of these skins, you can tweak them further than just what I'm showing, like these icons where you see the little film strip icon and the pluses. You can turn that off if you don't like those and just show the verbiage. And there's other things that you can customize, like how the thumbnails are tiled, what thumbnails are shown. They call these widgets when you're on the home screen, and how you choose what widgets are shown. So you can select maybe a random view of widgets, or you can have it alphabetized, that type thing. Nox is a good example of a skin that's extremely configurable, looks really nice, but it's sort of slow. It's a little bit heavy for my taste. But do keep in mind, see, I've got some errors here and whatnot. If you've customized for one skin, some of those customizations might not carry to another skin. And so you have to re-customize for the skins that you end up settling on. Now, if you like Confluence a lot, but you wish you could customize it, you probably would like Xonfluence or Zonfluence. I'm not really sure how to pronounce it. But it's a very, very cool skin. Starts out looking just like Confluence, but you really, really can customize it a lot. Unfortunately for the Pi, it's just way too heavy. I would not recommend it at all if you're running on a Pi. But if you're not running on a Pi and you can spare the resources, I like it. I think it's pretty cool. Another interesting skin would be Black Glass Nova. And it kind of has a look and feel similar to the Windows 7 Arrow. If you guys remember the translucent borders around the Windows from Windows 7 default skin. I mean, it's really nice and slick looking. But I didn't have too much trouble with it. It didn't seem too heavy to me. But as slick looking as it is, it might be once you get it configured. But I haven't really dug in and customized it much, but you can see you can definitely customize these home menu items, and it's very configurable. I kind of like it. I mean, if it doesn't bog things down too much, I might try this out some. I'll be aware, guys, that the number of skins that come bundled with the Kodi install is sort of limited. You're going to want to click get more ... to get more skins from the official Kodi repo. And you can always add other repos if there's not enough skins in here for you to choose from. However, I do generally recommend stick with the Kodi repo because you're less likely to have headaches that way. Here you can see I'm downloading Amber. And it'll download and install and switch to that skin right away. Amber's another one of those lightweight skins. It's targeted for smaller, less powerful platforms like the Raspberry Pi. And I find it is indeed very snappy, works very good. I'm not a huge fan of this Amber color, but I'm pretty sure you can change that if you don't like it. And it is very configurable, so it might be one worth trying out. However, for me, for now, I've kind of settled in on one that I like, which is Eminence 2.0. It's a pretty old skin. It's been around a while, but it's maintained and it's kept up to date. It is sort of minimalistic, sort of lightweight. It's very snappy. It's very configurable. But, of course, I'm not really married to it, right? I might change my mind later. That's the beauty of the skins. So that does it for this episode, guys. I hope it's been helpful. Be sure to stay tuned for the next episode where I'll get into some advanced Kodi configs, including configuring multiple Kodi devices with a shared common database, playlists and smart playlists, as well as detailed customizations of your skin, including customizing these home menu items. But as far as basic Kodi config and importing your media into your Kodi library, that's how it's done.